Hey, you got yourself a camera and maybe you're a beginning photographer. Maybe you've been shooting for a while, you've taken some classes, you've gone through YouTube, you've seen all the tutorials, you're looking at all these buttons, wondering what they are, and you're still a little bit confused and you're not getting predictable results, either too bright, too dark, or whatever. In this video, I'm gonna explain to you how I think about exposure and the questions that I ask myself before I even push the shutter button so that I can get predictable results almost every time, and if I don't, I make an adjustment, and that video is gonna start right now. Hey everybody, my name is Sean Seymour. I own a photography studio in Sacramento, California, and in this video, I'm going to try and help you get predictable results with your exposure settings. I'm going to explain a little bit what your camera is. I'm going to explain how I think about the way that light flows into your camera, the decisions, the creative decisions that you get to make along that path. And then I'm going to explain a little bit about ISO and a little bit about noise. And at the very end of this video, I'm gonna show you my settings for being outside or my settings for being inside, and then how I make adjustments quickly so that I get the results that I want. This is gonna be a basic explanation of light as far as natural light. I'm not gonna be talking about strobes or flash. I will be doing a video, maybe it's up here, I'm not sure, about strobes and flash at some point, but right now, this is just gonna be covering natural light. Recently, I've gotten some emails from friends who are also beginning photographers, and they are still questioning, after taking several classes, they're still questioning what some of these buttons do, like what is ISO? I'm gonna explain all of that in this video. Even though I'm going to keep it simple, I will explain it so that you are able to have a firm understanding of what ISO does, what exposure does, and how the buttons on your camera and the settings that you choose will affect the images that you're getting. Here's a general way that I think about exposure settings. Photography is like a balancing act. You might have to give up creativity in one area to gain some creativity in another area. So what do I mean by that? What I mean by that is, let's say that you want to have a wider depth of field. In other words, you want more of the background and the foreground to be in focus. I might have to give up some shutter speed in order to bring in enough light to allow me to take my aperture to a smaller aperture so that I can increase my depth of field. That's what I'm talking about. Photography is a trade-off between creativity, and you reach this balance of where the image is going to be its best. Let's get started. Your goal as a photographer, 100%, before considering creativity, before considering capturing the moment, before considering any of that other stuff, your goal as a photographer is 100% to get the best quality data that you can. That seems a little weird, right? Aren't we talking about photography and light capture data? Aren't we talking about capturing images? Aren't we talking about capturing moments in time and sealing forever those fun things and moving people's minds and all of that? No, right now what we're talking about is your ability to capture quality data. Why do I say that? I say that because you may or may not realize it, but your camera is actually a computer. Its job is to convert light into data and then store it for later use, either to display on your computer, your laptop, or your phone, whatever. That's the job of your camera. It's literally a computer. For those of you that are not familiar with the internal workings of your camera, the sensor is where the light that comes into your camera gets converted into data and then stored on your SD card or your storage medium for your camera. Many of us are still thinking about photography in the old school way of thinking about it. What do I mean by that? I mean, isn't photography where you have a camera and you have a camera lens and it has some mechanics in it, and inside the camera is, you know, all these other mechanics and things that work? No, not anymore. As a matter of fact, our cameras today are getting more and more electronic and software firmware based than they ever are mechanical. In the old days, we used to use a camera like this to capture light on film. And I don't know if you can see this. There we go. But that's the old school way of doing it. This is a physical thing, right? It's a piece of film. This particular film is over 50 years old. I meant 30 years old, not 50. Holy crap. But this is a physical thing. It's 25, 30 years old, and it's physical. We don't have anything physical with our digital cameras. Everything that we do is data and capturing and converting light into data. The only time that we get something physical is if we take that data and we create a print on a piece of paper, or we print an image on like a coffee mug or a t-shirt. But that's the only time that we have something physical. Long gone are the days where we have devices that are capturing some image on a physical medium. Everything we do now with our digital cameras is creating, moving, storing, and later displaying data. That's it. Why does that matter? Well, because in addition to the discussion about proper lighting, we also need to understand how our camera or our computer actually looks at that light. Film, almost no flexibility. You had a few things you could do in the darkroom, and that was about it. With data, you can do all kinds of stuff. You can manipulate the data in all kinds of ways to get a final image that is just absolutely amazing and totally creative. When you understand the data, you'll also understand where data might be missing or where you may be able to do a better job of capturing better data, and that will help you with your final image. When we talk about light, really what we're talking about is light as it relates to being converted into data. Let's say I'm standing outside, it's bright sunny day. I've got my aperture wide open and I've got my shutter speed at a long shutter speed. Well, what's gonna happen is I'm absolutely gonna blow up that image. It's gonna be all white. It's gonna be completely blown out. The reason I want you to understand how your camera looks at things is because the data that your camera captures there is simply going to say blown out, too much, one little piece of data for white, nothing else. There's no other data to capture. If I was really, really dark, I would also have the same problem. There would be not much data there. Actually, it would be full of noise. We'll talk about noise later. When your settings are so bad that you've blown everything out, your camera doesn't capture any data. It just says that's pure white. When you go into editing, and I'll show you this in just a minute when we jump into Lightroom, there is no way for you to recover that data or recover that image. It literally doesn't exist. There was no data recorded. So part of the reason to understand the data is when you look at the data, you can say, oh, well, there's no data recorded there, or I didn't get much data there. So it makes sense why my image is doing what it's doing. So to look at that data, let's jump into Lightroom real quick. I'll show you what the data looks like when you're in editing software. So here we are in Lightroom. I have a picture of Kiara here. And if we go up to the top right-hand corner over here, you'll notice that we have something called a histogram. What that histogram does is it essentially shows us the quality and the amount of data that we have. You'll notice that there's a light side over here, and then there's the shadow side over here, or dark side. By the way, in photography, lights and darks are referred to as highlights and shadows. Right here in the middle of the histogram is what we would consider to be the quality data, or the best exposure. Let's jump over to an overexposed image of Sarah. Now you notice in this image that Sarah is completely blown out. There's no skin detail. The highlights are just absolutely blown out. And the way that I can tell is I go up to my histogram and you see here, I've got like data in the quality area, but that's just the background. The real data that I want is her skin tones, which have been moved all the way out here to the very edge. And Lightroom has a cool feature in that if I hover over this triangle, it will actually show me where Sarah has no data. It's literally white. To make my point about the fact that there is zero data there, and no matter how hard I try in the editing software to recover it, I can swing this all the way down here to where we're dark now. But if I look at this, I still have no data. It's just pure white. So that's what I'm talking about when I say that your camera is recording data. And if it doesn't record data because it's blown out, there is no recovering it in the editing software. Okay, here's another image of Sarah. Now this time it's really dark. You can see that we only have highlights of her skin out here, and the rest of the image is super dark. And that is easy to tell from our histogram. Our histogram says, oh my gosh, you got a little bit of data over here and a little bit of teeny weeny skin tone data over here, but that's it. And again, I can use Lightroom and that cool feature where they show the peaking, and here's where all the shadows are clipping. No data there. We're completely clipped. Let's go ahead and take a look at a well-exposed image. Here's Sarah again. And if you look at our data, you can see that we got a ton of data here, which is mostly the background. And then we also have some decent skin tones here, right in the quality area of data. And that's going to be the skin tone that you see here on her face and the rest of her. So when I look at this, I see this is a bunch of data that's captured. The only place that we have clipping is in the shadows of the coat, and I'm perfectly fine with that. This is the best quality of light and the best quality of data that you can get in a photograph. Let's move over to Mickey real quick. You notice that our histogram has just exploded. It has data everywhere, and that's because on this image, we have data everywhere. There's a little bit of clipping on the blacks or shadows here in her hair. And this is great. This is full of data. We can do a lot with this image because we've captured so much data. Okay, one word of caution. The histogram shows you what data was captured, and I will have a video at some point, maybe up here, on how to read a histogram. But for right now, just know that the histogram is a really great way to evaluate the data that you have to work with. One of the things you want to be careful of with a histogram is it can fool you sometimes. If you notice in this particular photograph of Julia, our histogram is saying, oh my gosh, you got whites way over here. All I got was whites. Well, yes, but we also got some good skin tones here. And you can see that in this photograph that it's mostly white, with just our subject, Julia, being the other colors in what was captured. So I don't really expect this to be completely full of data like it was with Mickey. Same thing here for Nate. We have a predominantly white photograph, and that's showing in the data that we have over here. But if you look down here on the bottom, we have a little bit of data, which is Stand and him, captured right there in the well-exposed area. Now, if you're shooting on white or you're shooting on black, you can expect that you're gonna have this one-sided histogram either direction. So that's how you can use the histogram in Lightroom to show you what kind of data you got and the quality of the data that you got, the quality of the exposure, and the amount of light that you brought in and converted to data. You also have a histogram on your camera, and there's a histogram in other software like Lightroom, Photoshop, Capture One. They all have histograms that you can take a look at. What kind of data did I capture? This is important for beginning photographers because it allows you to evaluate the images that you've been taking. You go out, you take shots, click, 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 and then take them back to your computer and evaluate them. One of the nice things about Lightroom that you can see over here in the right-hand side is that Lightroom captures the metadata from your camera. What that means is Lightroom is capturing what my shutter speed was, what my aperture was, what ISO I had, and whether or not I used a flash. It'll also tell you what kind of lens type you had and what focal length you were using during that shoot. So as a beginning photographer, make sure the metadata is turned on your camera if it has the ability to capture it for the photos that you're doing, and then also take a look when you're in your editing software and evaluate your image based on the quality of data that you brought and what your settings were at the time that you shot that. That way you start processing it and you can make changes the next time you're in that same environment and you want to take an image. So how do you get quality data from your camera? The very first thing you can do is properly expose the scene that you're in so that the best quality of light and the most amount of light can reach your sensor and be recorded to your storage medium on your camera. So Sean, what kind of settings do you use? And how do you think about light entering your camera so that you can get the proper exposure? I'm so glad you asked. I don't use the exposure triangle. I have found that the exposure triangle is confusing. It's literally an older diagram that was meant to give a relationship between the three things that used to control exposure, which was your aperture, your shutter speed, and back then was ASA or DIN, but nowadays has been merged into what's called ISO. The thing about the exposure triangle is that it's antiquated. connected. And I find that most beginning photographers have a very difficult time understanding how those relationships balance. It's almost like if you took a nail and a nail and a nail and you put a string between all of them, then it might make more sense. But that's really hard to do in the real world when you're out in the field. And from a practical standpoint, how do you think about that in your mind? So I'm going to give you a way to think about the flow of light and then give you some questions that you can ask yourself that will directly affect the amount of light that gets to your sensor. And by the amount of light, I also mean the quality of light that gets to your sensor. The first thing is something that you're actually going to decide very, very far ahead of time before you ever press the shutter button. And that is, how much light are you going to want collected by the lens that you're using? In the photography world, that's called a front element. Its sole job, meaning its only job, is to collect as much light as possible from the environment around it and redirect as much of that light as possible into the camera lens. The front element is the first component out of the three components that affect how much light goes to your sensor. That's a decision you're going to make at the camera shop, or is a decision that you'll make online when you purchase the lens. Lenses come in all flavors. Really big glass in the front, which is going to gather a ton of light, to small, not so expensive glass in the front, which doesn't gather very much light and usually are considered to be slower lenses. I have a video on lenses right up here if you want to take a look at that. And it explains better what the front element does and all the other components of the lens. But know that the front element is the first component of the three components that will affect the light that gets to your sensor. Number two and number three. Number two is your aperture and number three is your shutter. So let's talk a little bit about how the flow of light works and the decisions that you have to make along the way so that you can either bring lots of light or wish that you had more. There's two components that you're going to consider before you even press your shutter button. The very first one is the aperture. And the reason why this works for me is because the flow of light goes from the front element, and the first thing it runs into is the aperture. The aperture is where you will either have a small opening or a large opening, and that is where the depth of field can be adjusted. If you haven't seen my video on depth of field, check it out right over here. Here's an example of a shallow depth of field. If you look at my hand in the background, you'll notice my eyes are in focus, but my hand is not in focus. Sometimes you want to have a wide aperture and create a shallow depth of field because you don't want the foreground or the background in focus. You only want your subject in focus. And the opposite is true if you want to make a small aperture and you may want to increase your depth of field. So maybe I want to have my hand in focus. I would increase the depth of field by narrowing my aperture. Of course, that is going to reduce the amount of light. When the light passes the aperture, you'll see that there is not as much light. The amount of light that I have to work with has been reduced. Now, that's a creative decision that I may have made. I may have said I want a smaller aperture, and so I have less light going to my sensor. What is the next step that light takes when it's traveling through your camera? The next step is, after going through the aperture, it hits the shutter. Now at the shutter, you get another creative decision. You get to decide whether you want to have a fast shutter speed, which will freeze action and will also help with camera shake, or you get to decide you can have a long shutter speed, which might be something that you want to use from a creative standpoint to maybe make some cool images at the beach. If I choose a long shutter speed, it's because I purposefully want to blur action and almost use it to draw on my image. Now, the effect when I increase my shutter speed and freeze action, I don't allow much light to pass. So in this diagram again, let's assume that at my aperture, I made it a little bit smaller. Then at my shutter, I made my shutter a little bit faster to help freeze some action or take out some camera shake. And so I only have one arrow of light, which initially started as a whole bunch of light, has been cut down along the way to where it reaches my sensor. And now at my sensor, It gets converted to data, and then it gets recorded to my SD card. That is how my mind processes the exposure that I want to use, whether it be outdoors or it be inside, light or dark, it doesn't really matter. I go through the same process every time, and I ask myself those same questions. What kind of lens am I using? How much light am I gathering? What kind of aperture do I want? Do I want a wide aperture? Lots of light? Narrow aperture? Not as much light. And then what speed do I want my shutter speed? Do I want it to be a fast shutter speed and freeze action, help with the camera shake, or do I want a slow shutter speed? The slower the shutter speed, the more light passes through to the sensor. So you've bought the best lens that you can afford, and it has the biggest front element you can afford. You've adjusted your aperture, you've adjusted your shutter speed, and you still don't have enough light to make an image that when you go into post and readjust the exposure isn't going to have a bunch of noise in it. One of the things that you can do, and this is the only time you're going to do it, is raise your ISO. Your ISO is a fix to bad lighting. The only time you're gonna mess with your ISO is when you don't have enough light to use the other creative settings that you want for your aperture and your shutter speed. Aperture, shutter speed are what control the amount of light that enters your camera. ISO is just simply an amplification of that light that's already hit your sensor. This is where there's a misunderstanding in the photo community and just by and large, people not understanding ISO is not a way to increase the sensitivity of your sensor. All it does is take the small amount of light that's already hit your sensor and amplify it. It's like a volume knob on a stereo. Sooner or later, you start getting to a point where the quality suffers because you got it turned up too much. It's the same way with ISO. Here's a pro tip for you. It's usually a good idea, or a best practice, however you want to say it, to raise your ISO while you're shooting rather than think to yourself, you know what, I'm going to keep my ISO low and I will try to recover this through my editing software. In general, unless you're really cranking on the ISO, it's better to raise your ISO and get the photograph that you want versus trying to catch it in editing. And here's a good example. Let's say that I need a little bit more light in order to raise my shutter to freeze some action. If I raised my shutter but thought I was going to adjust that in post, I would actually be recording the noise that's there already in addition to taking it into my editing software. When you raise your ISO, some people assume that it creates more noise. In fact, that's a myth. What happens is, because we're already raising our ISO, we're actually in a low light situation and can't overpower the noise that is already there. So a pro tip is to try and raise your exposure in the field with ISO versus trying to make that adjustment in post using your editing software. I mentioned noise and I'll cover that very briefly. And I say in general because there is a lot of misunderstanding centered around noise and ISO in the photography community. Some people still think that we're talking about grain on film. And increasing your ISO will increase the noise that is actually in your photograph. That's not true. Actually, increasing your ISO does not increase your sensor sensitivity. All it does is increase that amplification. And you get a little bit more decrease of noise because your camera works harder to get rid of the digital noise. There's two kinds of noise in this world. One is called short noise. The other one is called digital noise. Short noise is actually in the universe. There is nothing you can do about it. It's because of the protons bouncing off of everything. It's little bits of light that are bouncing off of everything. And actually, when you get into a low light situation, our digital sensors on our camera can pick that up. Digital noise is actually created by the electronics in your camera. You can reduce some of the digital noise. And in fact, when you increase your ISO, it helps to reduce the digital noise. But because you're already in a low light situation, you're more than likely recording more short noise and not overwhelming the short noise with good quality light, which is the way that you combat noise. I know that that's not always possible in the real world when you're trying to take photographs in a dark room or whatever. There is some times where you're not gonna have enough light and you're going to record noise. In our situation, we want to try and overwhelm that by properly exposing the image and bringing in as much good quality light as we can to overwhelm that short noise. Here's a very quick example of what noise looks like in an image. And as I mentioned, the best best thing that you can do as a photographer to reduce the amount of noise in images is to bring as much and as large amount of quality light that you can to the sensor before that sensor records that light and converts it to data. Before you get into that situation, what I would recommend is that you practice what your camera's tolerances are for increasing the ISO. So what I mean by that is maybe go into a room that's not very well lit and take some pictures. Change up your ISO, adjust your shutter, adjust your aperture so that you can raise your ISO and still have proper exposure for that image. And then take it back to your editing software and take a look at what it looks like. Go all the way through your range of ISO on your camera, and you are going to be surprised at where that noise starts becoming noticeable. You may find that it doesn't become noticeable until you're at 1600, 800 ISO. I don't know. It's going to be particular to your camera, so I would say check it out so that the next time you're in a room and you've got your settings, the creative shutter speed and aperture, the way that you want them, now you know how far you can take your ISO before you're going to start losing the picture quality that you want. I realize this is a very simplified explanation about noise and about ISO and how it works with digital cameras. The takeaway from this is that ISO should be your last adjustment. You should be adjusting your aperture and your shutter speed first before you use ISO. One of the reasons that I suggest that you do not shoot on priority modes and that you shoot in manual to start out, and I know that many photography classes start with shooting on priority modes. One of the reasons I suggest that you don't do that and you shoot on manual is because in priority modes, the computer or the camera is taking care of some of that decision making for you. And you don't really know if you don't know what those decisions are. I would suggest that you set yourself on manual, you make those creative choices as you ask yourself what you want as a result from the image, and then if you run into a wall and you don't have enough light, then adjust your ISO. All right, I told you at the beginning of the video that I would give you some suggestions to get you going. One of my first suggestions is shoot in manual. I know there's a lot of controversy over this, but if you shoot in manual, you ask yourself the questions about aperture, ask yourself questions about shutter speed, all before you take your first picture, then you take your first picture. After you take your first picture, you're going to look at the back of the LCD screen. I'm sure that someone somewhere along the way has told you to use your light meter in your camera. I'm telling you, forget it. Don't worry about your light meter anymore. Don't ever look at it again. If you want to get like a general feel for an area, go ahead and meter it. But frankly, if you're using your light meter, it's probably going to be wrong, and it's not going to be the image that you're going to see in the back of the LCD screen. Keep in mind that this LCD screen is not perfect either. That's why I suggest that you shoot on manual, because I can ask myself, do I want a wide or shallow depth of field, which is my aperture? Do I want to freeze motion? Do I want to help my camera shake? Or do I want to blur something? That's my shutter speed. And once I've answered those questions and made those settings, long before I've ever pushed the button, I can take a picture, I can look at it and go, oh, nope, I'm too dark. Let me adjust something. Boom. Pooh. Here's my next picture. Oh, that's dialed. Okay. Picture, 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 picture. I'm ready to go. If you ask yourself those questions before you ever start shooting, I guarantee you that you will become much faster and a much better photographer. Then the argument is, hey, I got this expensive camera. Why don't I let it do some of the decision making for me? That's fine. If you want it to do the decision making for you on aperture priority mode or shutter priority mode, great, go for it. If you walk into a dark room and you just want to put it on your ISO priority mode, okay, that's fine too. I recommend that you don't use the ISO priority mode, because what's going to happen is this thing is going to start adjusting to an ISO that is going to give you a huge amount of noise, and you may not know that it's doing that at the time. So once you test your camera and understand what your ISO range are and where that noise starts becoming a problem, you will know, oh, I can go ahead and adjust my ISO up to right here and continue to shoot. And you don't need to go into the automatic mode. If you learn to shoot in the manual mode, the aperture priority mode and the shutter priority mode will make all the sense in the world to you. But if you learn to shoot in those modes first and you don't understand what your camera is doing, then your path to getting to be a good photographer to where you understand what's going on is just going to get longer. So I would suggest that you stay in manual mode, ask yourself a few of those questions before you shoot. Go ahead and take a couple of shots, look in the back of your camera, and then make adjustments from there. So where do you start on an indoor scene? If I'm in the studio, or let's say I'm walking into a reasonably well-lit restaurant, I already know by looking at the scene that I'm going to be shooting at maybe 1/60th, maybe 1/100th of a second. That's about as low as you can go and still handhold your camera. I'm also going to open up my aperture as wide as it goes. Most of these cameras have pretty good focal abilities, autofocus systems, and so on. And so I can go ahead and open my aperture up all the way and not worry about being in focus. Take a shot. Oh, I look a little bit dark. Okay, well, I'm maxed out on my shutter speed. I can't go any lower. I'm going to be blurry. And my aperture is as wide as it'll go. I can't go any wider because that's as wide as that lens goes. Well, now I can raise up my ISO. That's how I would go about approaching an indoor setting. How do I approach an outdoor setting? Well, let's say I'm walking outside into the sun. There's something called the Sunny 16 rule, which has you shooting at 1/25th of a second at f/16, ISO 100, and you should be relatively properly exposed. That's because the sun hasn't changed in bazillions of years. Then you can work from that if you want to. I'm not a guy that likes to shoot at f/16, so I usually will bring it back down to, say, f/5.6 or something like that. Or if I'm shooting portraits or something along those lines, I might be in it even as low as f/1.8, 1.6, or somewhere in there. So if that's the case, I'm gonna have to increase my shutter speed to make up the difference. Now, my camera goes to 1/8,000th of a second, but some of the cameras out there stop at 1/2,000th of a second. So you're gonna have to keep that in mind. Remember, I said that photography is a balancing act between all these creative questions that you get to ask. So if I want a shallow depth of field and I want my aperture wide open, can I shoot with my shutter speed at 1/8,000th of a second? If the answer is yes, I'm good to go. If the answer is no, I've got to figure out something else. So that's where I start for an outdoor scene or an indoor scene. Those are the two kind of settings that I would start with as I walk into the environment. As soon as I take my first shot, I'm looking at that LCD screen. I don't even care if my first shot's in focus. A lot of times I'll just push the button at whatever. So then I'll look at it, I make my adjustments, I'll take another photograph, make a quick adjustment, and now I'm ready to go. Not only did I get to ask myself all of the creative questions, and so I'm actually shooting the shot that I want, but I also was able to make adjustments in a few seconds, and then I can go ahead and shoot shots the rest of the evening as long as my lighting situation doesn't change. As soon as my lighting situation changes, I immediately take a quick shot, take a look, and I make the creative adjustments that I want. I feel like that if you will keep your camera in manual mode and you will continue to process those ideas in your head, then you can go ahead and use priority modes and you'll know exactly what's going on. I hope you found this video helpful, and I hope it helps you nail your exposure and bring the best quality of light you can to your sensor where it can record some really good data. Hopefully, if you were struggling with getting consistent results before, thinking about the flow of light through the front of your lens all the way to your sensor, and then understanding that there's only two places there that you're gonna make adjustments that will bring either more or less light to your sensor, and that your ISO is literally the last thing that you're going to adjust, I hope that gives you enough to work with to go out and practice a little bit while keeping it on manual and being able to get predictable results every single time you go out. If you found this video helpful, please hit the like button down below, do the YouTube thing, and subscribe. In the meantime, I hope you expose everything, and I hope you expose it correctly, and keep it simple, my friend. Overheating again? It's like listening to a little kid play in a sandbox with a hammer.